This is Ernest Tubb, and this is also Ernest Tubb.
We're both Ernest Tubb, and you're listening to Walking the Floor.
That's the best fucking intro liner anybody's done yet. Thank you. Thank you.
I'm walking the floor over you.
Walking the floor.
I'm walking the floor.
Walking the floor over you.
Hola, senors and senoritas. This is Chris Shiplett, as always. Welcome to episode 191 of Walking the Floor. The big news this week, you may have seen, we dropped that cool Vans Foot the Bill Foo Fighter Jensen's guitar and music collaborative shoe and t-shirt. Which, I don't know if you know about Vans Foot the Bill. It's a program that Vans has that raises money for small businesses that are out there struggling. And we were able to raise some money for my favorite guitar store in the whole world, my hometown shop, the spot that I learned how to play guitar in. And I'm very, very happy to say that the shoe sold out like, you know, in a day or something like that. So thank you, thank you, thank you to everybody out there that bought that shoe. It really does go to a great little store and a great family, great people. And I think it's the last guitar store in Santa Barbara. So that's a cool thing. Thank you. Appreciate it from the bottom of my heart. And Vans was having a problem with their website where they didn't get the shirt up at the same time, but I think it went up. I'm taping this on Friday. This thing's going to post on Monday. I think it went up today, and I don't know if there's going to be any left by the time this thing posts, but if you want to check that out, get over there and get a t-shirt too. It all goes in the big pot to raise some money for Jensen's Music in Santa Barbara, where my brother Mike Shiplett is a guitar teacher. And if you're interested, hit them up, because Mike Shiplett can teach you how to play. I'm not even kidding. Any Ritchie Blackmore solo you can think of, that dude knows how to play it. So, there you go. Jensen's Music, Vans, Foot the Bill, Foo Fighters, boom! What a collaboration. Fantastic stuff. And now, I know that there were a few people that tried to get the shoe and you know, didn't get there fast enough and it was sold out. And I hear you. I feel your pain. Please, stop yelling at me on Twitter. It's not my fault. I put right there in the post, limited supplies. I'm sorry, man. But thank you to everybody that did buy it anyway. All right, let's talk about my good friends at Zounds.com. You know, nobody, and I mean nobody on the internet, makes the best gear from the best brands more affordable than Zounds. You never have to pay full price all at once. You can use their payment plans. And did you know that they never charge you interest? Ever. Never charge interest. Zounds.com. There you go, man. Check it out. Get on over there, Zounds.com, and we're going to get right to today's interview now. On today's episode, I've got Josh and Sam from the young rock and roll band Greta Van Fleet, who just released their third full-length, The Battle at Garden's Gate. I mean, it's kind of their third full-length, because I think they had an EP and then another EP combined with that EP. So it's kind of the debut record, but not really, but whatever. Who cares? Greta Van Fleet, great young rock and roll band, who have somehow managed to claw their way to the top of the scrap heap in the music industry, even though rock and roll bands don't seem to break through to the mainstream very often, but they have, so you gotta give them credit for that. And they've taken their fair share of stick over the years with Led Zeppelin comparisons and all that sort of thing, but we talk about that a bit, and they take that in stride, and they're really nice, nice young dudes, and I enjoyed talking to them a whole lot. This is Josh and Sam from Greta Van Fleet on Walking the Floor. All right, let's jump into this and talk about your fantastic new record, The Battle at Garden's Gate. This is a great opportunity for you guys to just shit talk Greg Kirsten. Come on, do it.
Yeah, you know.
Where are we starting?
I know. Yeah. How did you he'll never hear this. Come on, man. It's a very small listenership.
He doesn't care. Yeah, he's busy doing other shit. I think that's the most entertaining part about the whole thing. It doesn't really matter what you say. I mean, what is he gonna he's not gonna catch word of any of that.
No, he's gonna chill out in Hawaii and
that's right. Boy.
You're out in Greg Kirsten. we all know, of course, he's a super, super amazing producer, but how was he for you guys to work with? Was that the first time you guys have recorded with him?
Yes. Yeah. Yes, it was.
Yeah. We kind of met with him and in the summer of 2019, his then house, I guess.
Yeah, right? The Laurel Canyon.
And he had this studio that downstairs, and we kind of all got together and got talking. And just his knowledge of music history is one thing. And that's like such a fascinating conversation to have with him. Just kind of bring up about anything. I mean, he's a total nerd. It's great. And he's one of the funniest people I've ever met. So it's like we kind of got a really good feel for the whole thing. And that was made sense to us that this is a good idea. His name, of course, was on the top of our list. We wanted to work with Greg, and we were kind of honored that he wanted to work with us. So we got in the studio and started just with a single track to see how it would go. And we kind of put together Light My Love, and it was like, yeah, this is it. This is a good thing.
His musical dexterity is, it's everything.
So that's a really good way of putting that. He's like, one of the things, I mean, as a guitar player tracking with Greg, I love, like, I'll go to him, like, what if we did something like, you know, that one guitar thing from, you know Your Rights, and he's just like, boom, and he knows exactly what you're talking about, and he knows how to get it.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, he's always on the same page somehow.
Yeah, it's like he's able to like observe and know kind of more technically what you're doing musically, which is, I mean, that's kind of how Greg is. But yeah, and then that was a cool thing, because we set out to do this album. We're like thinking, well, you know, it's going to be a challenge. And it was like Greg was going to be the one to be able to capture that thing, you know, the scope that we were going for.
Now, I remember when we were making the latest Foos record, which was quite a while ago now, I remember him talking about working with you guys. So was your album, was it sort of pre-COVID and post-COVID?
Yeah, actually.
Yeah, lived through all the stages.
That's right.
Most of it was recorded just about 2 years ago. And we went really? Back to LA full on pandemic. When was that? Just 9 months ago or something?
Yeah, not too long.
And we finished it out with two tracks that we thought were important to the cohesiveness of the record itself.
And that was weird, because it's like you're recording the bulk of the album one way, and then you get together and it just, you know, really very different. So much had changed from the time we had left the studio to the time we went back. And, you know, we went from everybody just, I mean, hanging out to kind of, you know, sort of spread out around the control room with masks on. It was just kind of weird. I think it might've affected that, not negatively, but just in a way, some kind of, it is weird.
Yeah, it is. I mean, we've been working through, you know, once we decided, because at first, like everybody else, you know, we put our record on hold and put everything on hold. But then we started working really like towards the end of summer. And it was such a bizarre thing. We weren't recording exactly, but just to be in a room with other people after months and months of sort of thinking that if you're in any contact with anybody, you're going to die or you're going to kill your family or whatever. It definitely had some kind of weird pressure to the whole thing.
No, that's for sure. Yeah, it was like, yeah, that's certainly that point where everybody, it was very obvious that nobody knew what the fuck was going on. It was kind of like, okay, what do we do?
And also,
what is this thing? And it was like, I mean, so yeah, and we were finished.
Realized that it wasn't going to end.
Right.
So it's like, how do we deal with this in a creative way?
So it was like, yeah, we're going to go back. We didn't fly. We got this big RV and drove it from Nashville to Los Angeles.
Old fashioned way.
Yeah.
Wait, do you guys live in Nashville? Or are you in Nashville now?
Yeah, we live in Nashville now.
Yeah. We kind of hunkered down here at the beginning of 2020.
I was in Nashville a couple of weeks ago or a week and a half ago to do a little recording of my own, and timed it exactly when all those crazy storms were.
Oh yeah,
it's like, nice. We were like, you know, in between takes, you'd hear like crazy thunder going on outside, and I somehow missed all the flooding. I heard about it mostly kind of when I got home. But were you guys affected by that?
Well, you know, it floods all the time.
It floods, yeah. And we just take the kayak.
The scary part are the tornadoes. Like when I'm sure when you were here, you see the sky turn yellow, and then the hail's coming down, the wind starts picking up.
It's Were you in town for that that hailstorm that came down? I mean,
I think so. Yeah, I mean, I went out there for like 5 days, and I literally just worked from like
from beginning
to end. So it was kind of a blur. I could just kind of hear the storm going on, but I was getting texts from all my friends in other places. It's like, dude, are you okay?
Totally crazy. Yeah.
Which studio did you record at?
A few, actually. I did a couple days. I'm like doing this kind of creative experiment where I'm going to probably not make an album. I'm just going to go record with different people and record some songs here and record some songs there. So I did a couple of songs with Vance Powell at Sputnik. And then I did a couple of songs with Jaren from Cadillac 3. I've drawn a blank on what the one of them was. Sound Emporium, which was awesome. Jack Clement's old place. And it's just like really cool. Old studio. And I forget what the name of the other place. So anyway, I was at a few different places.
That's the place that you want to be when the shit hits the fan. Totally. I want to be in a recording studio when the tornado happens.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah. I knew it was real when at one point, you know, when the storm first hit, Vance was like, hey, don't worry. We got a basement here. So, you know, the shit goes. Like, really? Is that a possibility? We're gonna have to like drop the guitars and run.
Yeah. Like, no, leave it in the trash. Just let it bleed.
Yeah. It's funny because somebody was like, man, you guys have earthquakes out in California. You know, I was like, yeah, earthquakes don't make the fucking sky look like a Harry Potter movie. It's scary. They come and go quick.
Yeah, that's true.
So all in, you know, how was this like lost year for you guys?
It was found. We found the year.
That's right.
Once again, working with something on such a global scale like this, it's a challenge to creatively deal with the problems. But we think with every fence, every kind of blockade, there's a way to deal with it that can work out in your favor.
I don't know. Yeah, it was like finding the silver lining was the good thing. And I'm just kind of keeping really busy and watch the world get weirder and weirder. And then kind of like maybe harness that for some kind of creative fuel. But yeah, the time allowed us to do other things that been like so crazy for so long. It was, I think, really an appropriate time to kind of reconnect. You know, there's hardly any room to breathe. I mean, you get it, but it's so. I think this has been good for meditation, reflection, and we've been able to just. I mean, I've been doing more reading and painting, which is totally the biggest pain in the ass if you're trying to do that while touring. It's just doesn't cover so well.
You know, I found myself honestly like outside of the sort of chaos out in the world.
Yeah.
At the same time, you know, I felt almost like guilty that I was enjoying being home so much because, you know, like you, I'm on the road a lot. You know, I'm away from my family a lot. I imagine since you guys really like put out your first EP, you guys have probably been on tour most of the time.
Yeah.
And it's kind of like it's a welcome break to kind of recharge and just get to not have anything on the horizon for a while.
Yeah. That's kind of how we saw it.
Reconnect with some kind of reality.
Yeah.
Right. Right. Yeah, I felt like almost like guilty talking. People go like, oh, you must be so bummed to not be on the road. I was like, well, not that bummed. It's going to come back. Come on, you know?
Yeah, no kidding, right? Let's say it's a different thing. It's not any worse or any better. You know, it is a different thing. It's like a shift of gears. But that's been, it's been great. You know, it's been fun.
Hey, how do you guys write songs? Do you guys write? Does everyone in the band write? Is it one or two of you that kind of take the lead on it? How do you guys get your songs together?
Everybody writes.
I think it comes from just anything that inspires us, a chord progression, a melody, a tone, and working from there and finding the seed and growing that.
And somebody kind of brings in an initial idea generally, and then everybody goes to work on that and starts, you know, spinning off ideas and writing and doing what they do to, you know, and so I guess it's kind of, it is spontaneous and it's kind of, I think, really enjoyable that way. We don't really know where it's going to come from, but something's going to happen. You know?
I mean, you know, with most bands or sort of creative partnerships, there's some sort of like, you know, polite obligation to not be too harsh when you're working on stuff with other people. I mean, maybe you think like, oh, that fucking sucks, but you're not going to say that out loud or what, you know what I mean? Given the fact that three of the four of you are brothers, are you guys just like brutally honest with each other?
Oh yeah. 100%.
Fuck that idea sucks.
No, really.
Try again, try harder.
Yeah. There will be nothing that is lost in communication.
No, not at all. Yeah. I mean, sometimes it can get out of control, but when you have, again, somebody like Greg, he's like, you know, everything is good, you know? But yeah, we'll get it. It's like time to go into that soundproof room for a bit, you know, and throw some shit and then get through it. But yeah, it's, you can be blatantly honest at the end of the day, everything's all right.
Because it's important. And if it's not the way that you want it to be, then it's not perfect.
Right. I imagine your drummer being like the interband referee. Like, all right, come on. You can't actually punch him in the face. Hold on.
Yeah.
I think that does happen.
I mean, you know, like the brother bands are sort of there's a well-known history in rock and roll of that, you know, having fireworks and oftentimes ending poorly or whatever. Are you guys sort of aware of that and conscious of that and work to not do that? I mean, what are the sort of the pros and cons of being in a band with family?
Well, I guess sort of, I think it's seeing kind of some of the shit that's transpired in, you know, so many decades of having the sort of conflict between brothers and bands is sort of a reminder that, you know, at the end of the day, you're brothers and you're just going to get along because you're family and it's better that way. And then to just sort of separate and ego gets in the way or something. But I think it's sort of like being around the world and being in, you don't really feel like you're alone in any of that. You kind of have that support system, you know, you get your brothers with you. So that's, I think, a huge help. And it makes it a lot more fun too, you know, in a lot of ways. So then it's like, how much more fun can you have after a while? Especially when you all enjoy, you know, getting in the golf cart, going to the radio tent after they've closed and ransacking the place, you know, that's
the mischief. It's very real. When we started off, we didn't really believe in the fact that this rock and roll lifestyle was real.
The way that Hollywood would portray it or something or whatever. But yeah, it seems that was, we soon...
It's alive and well.
Let's hold on now. Let's drill down. You can't just throw that out there and then not provide any details. I mean, I imagine when you guys first started, you know, touring and really getting a lot of attention, you were very young. Did you have like a minder come out with you to sort of help or to try to protect you guys from the types of excesses that you're talking about? So it didn't turn into like teenage Aerosmith 1977.
I don't know. A certain degree. Yeah. I think we always had a very strong foot in reality for the most part. I think we know our limits and especially when it interferes with our writing, our performance, because that's our bread and butter. That's our life. So if you're like drinking too much and get up on stage and you perform like shit, I mean, there's probably
that one's on you, you know?
Yeah, that's on you.
But it never stopped us in the past.
No.
Or never stopped anyone in the past.
And I've definitely hit that wall a couple times where I've left the stage and gone, holy shit, I probably overdid that. Maybe a little less next time. But yeah, no, I think there's always been like a little bit of some kind of eyes, you know, or something. There is some kind of protection, but I don't think that, I mean, we've seen, you know, some of the greatest minds of their time destroyed by excess. So I don't know. It's choose the good drugs.
that's up for debate, I suppose. as to what are the good drugs?
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
I mean, was there a point when you got to a certain age where you, you know, pushed back on that at all? Like, I mean, I assume it would have been like your parents or relatives or something that were sort of helping you, guide you.
No, but yeah,
not yet.
No. Still look to get rotten, you know, and whatnot.
I think it's what happens after the shows. That's when things start happening.
Oh, sure, yeah. It's the cycle of touring, you know. It's like you have a big night and then you got a show the next night. So you're like, well, I'm just gonna have a couple of beers, just kind of get through this. The show's over. You're like, I feel like a million bucks. Like,
yeah, I'm into it all.
Yeah.
So there's that. No, yeah. I don't know. Nobody's ever told us don't do that, which is a great thing because then we're gonna go do that if somebody says don't do it. So
we have just enough self-control.
I like to think so, but yeah.
So I watched the video for Heat Above, and I was really struck by how it's like 6 minutes long. And I was imagining like in this modern world of short attention spans that must have been, you must have had to convince some suits at your label or somebody to let you do that.
Yeah, especially releasing it as a radio single.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. And I think one of our goals also as this very modern rock and roll band is to change the way people think about radio music, because radio will innately die if they just keep spinning the same shit that they've been doing. But what we have seen over the pandemic are these rock stations are playing a much larger variety of things, and they're doing way better. And the alt stations are kind of sticking with what is tried and true, and they're kind of faltering. It's like, wow, we could have told you that a long time ago. But I think it's, I think the musical diversification is important, especially not to insult the listener's intelligence by playing them something that's a formulaic hit.
Right. Yeah. It's always that.
It's interesting. Like, where do you guys kind of live radio wise? Like, do you get played by alt stations and more sort of hard rock stations?
It's like at the beginning, it was definitely rock stations. But in the last year or two, it seems to be going even a broader, you know, kind of more
AAA, it's indie.
Indie, yeah.
A lot of different stuff.
Yeah. And that's cool. That's really cool to see, you know?
So we fit into a few different categories. And as
was it, I was going to say, those definitions have evolved so much over the last 25 years. It's interesting to see that, like with the new Foo Fighter record, where, you know, certain singles do well and where they don't get attention, and it's all kind of changing.
Yeah.
It is. And it's, and that's, we have such a problem with these people who try to track what's popular and like, oh, you know, Ed Sheeran released this song and it has marimba on it. Let's make a marimba track. And then
you gotta get the marimba in there. Remixing the entire record. It's all marimba now.
Yeah. No, it's good. This is good.
Yeah. Following trends is just, you're just innately behind before you even start. So, I don't know.
If you're trying to jump on the wagon of, you know, something, I think, yeah, the best way to do music or to make music is probably to sort of trust your own original instinct and make the stuff that's kind of close to home and where you really take on what you feel and put down something organic,
It's authentic.
It's so common to see manufactured stuff, you know. It's really interesting. Even labels will go, oh, they look a certain way. Let's have somebody come in and write. So they have like 50 writers to make these songs, and it's and then they bring the stylist. They manufacture the stuff. There's a bit of a conveyor belt sometimes.
It's wild, you know. That was one of the things I loved about when, I forget when it was, we played a couple festivals with you guys, and I went out and watched some of your set. And I was like, God, this is so great that they're not, or at least to my ear, it didn't sound like you were playing to track. Like, you know, it was like,
no, never. Was,
you could hear the holes. You could hear the space. It was like, fuck, this is a real band. Like, I get why people are responding to this, you know, in the room. It's such a fascinating thing because, I mean, you probably get this comment or question all the time. Like, we hear all the time, you know, God, why aren't there rock bands anymore? Where are the rock bands? You know, that whole thing. And there's such a nostalgia for classic rock and in the bands that still exist, you know, that Stones, Aerosmith, whoever went go on tour and still play these huge places. And yet there isn't a lot of it in the mainstream. And there certainly aren't a lot of young bands that are getting through to the mainstream. What's your sense of all that? And how did you guys get through?
See, that's a tough question. I think it's perhaps projection. They're not exactly hitting their stride yet, because we played together for maybe 4 years before we released anything.
Yeah, I don't know.
And it takes a long time to develop and become that band, because the band is important, as we were just talking about. There's a lot of chemistry that can happen. And that's what it's for.
Kind of ultimately a little weird or a little strange, the fact that, you know, we've had the success that we've had. I still can't wrap my head around what separates us entirely from so many really, really great rock and roll bands that I've heard and that we've played with. But I guess it's kind of like our intentions are honest. I mean, we're not faking something. And no, we're not playing to tracks. No, we're not. And, you know, we have a huge respect for the music, that the rock and roll music that we grew up on. And and we kind of got together and started playing, and this is kind of what we sounded like, and I guess people responded to that, you know. So I don't know.
Perhaps it's the labels that are squashing the success. Well,
yeah, then you've got this whole industry thing, right? And we've really since the beginning been able to have full creative, control. We've been able to do so much, and nobody's interfered. And the philosophy there is, I think, don't fix what's not broken. That's what, at least, you know, people like Jason Flom are saying. It's really interesting to see that happen.
Well, that's a really good point, and that's kind of my theory on it. Because it seems to me that there's a lot of young rock bands, even though, you know, I see like with my kids and stuff that there aren't a lot of young people of a certain age picking up guitars, bass, and drums, but there seems to be a lot of rock bands. But it's, so is the question that, you know, if from the broader public thinking, like, why are there no rock bands in the mainstream anymore? Is that an issue of the gatekeepers of industry?
I think most of the time it has to do with the gatekeepers of industry. And I wish I knew their names and where they live. I mean, it's this whole mysterious kind of clandestine, cult. And I don't know what it is, but I do fully think that they take these young bands, these people with a lot of promise, and try to make them something that they're not. And, and something that the people don't necessarily want either. And, they get lost in the mix.
Yeah. You got to let something, I think, naturally evolve and trust your intuition and, you know, stick to your guns, because they'll chew you up and spit you out, you know, if you let them.
Well, on that subject, what is it that I'm failing to do with my own children that your parents apparently did well, that got you to not only listen to some classic rock, but actually like it and want to go play it?
Well, did you play them the blues?
Fuck, I knew it was something. I played them some bluesy stuff. I mean, come on, man. I got a pretty good record collection. I played them the Beatles and the Stones and AC/DC and the Pogues and all the good stuff. And I don't know. It didn't take.
I think it's probably something to do maybe with the fact that if we were listening, we weren't really aware of the stuff that we growing up that wasn't given to us sort of in a way. Our parents were listening to it and we were hearing it, and we didn't really know what was, like, you know, pop music of the time until we were in, like, you know, grade school or high school, really. I mean, it was kind of like, we didn't really listen to radio. We listened to the vinyls and all of the, and the CDs and the cassettes and all of that stuff.
For a long time.
Where did you guys grow up?
Frankenmuth, Michigan, little town, an hour north of Detroit. So, but yeah, I don't know. It's kind of like I guess we didn't really know what that stuff was. So
well,
I guess
know, like, about
our
radio.
All of this stuff is in our DNA, I guess, you know, and it feels familiar. Right? We identify with it, I suppose.
Did you have a sense of the of the Michigan, like, musical heritage? Like, were you aware of MC5 and Iggy and Bob Seger and, you know, whatever, the classic sort of rock stuff that came out of your state?
We knew about Stevie Wonder.
of course, right, because Motown, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, there's a lot of that. Because I mean, people like Aretha Franklin are, like, not, you know, from Michigan, but was right. Like Motown, you know, really there. We were aware of that stuff for sure, you know. That's sure. What, you know, we were hearing growing up, so, and that was the stuff that our parents were listening to, so.
Like, was there ever a point when you guys were getting into playing music when you were kids that one of you sort of lagged behind the others or got disinterested in it? Like, did you ever have to, like, you know, come on, man, practice your scales?
Well, yeah, actually, kind of, yes. I feel like Jake was always pushing for this thing, and he was going to start a band no matter what. I don't think he knew that it was going to be with his brothers. But Josh and I would casually come in, and it was like a casual thing. It wasn't a serious commitment in any way. And I remember for a few months, I was like, bass is boring. I don't want to do this anymore. But it loops you back in. Oh, and then I heard about Jack Bruce, and then I started playing bass again.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think we all slowly got more and more serious about it as we got better and wrote better songs.
And how old were you guys when you started gigging a lot, where it became more of, like, this is not just a hobby we're not just kids doing like some little teenage hobby. This is like becoming a real thing.
I think that was pretty much, that was about 13 and 16.
Really? How old were you when your first, EP came out?
It was 2017. Jeez.
17? I was 17. I think they were 20.
Yeah, that's right.
And did it seemed to me from the outside looking in, you know, like all of a sudden I heard your name and everybody was talking about your band, but it's always different when you're in it.
I think that's what Highway Tune did. I think that there was something so innately so simple and attitude about it that people instantly kind of gravitated toward it, especially the rock fans. And that's where we got our footing in as a serious band.
It's always hard to have perspective from the inside of the thing as well. Like you're in the eye of the storm and there's everything just sort of kind of, I guess, flying around all around you. It's just like so many people, so much things all the time. So, and of course we weren't reading articles and that sort of thing, you know. I wouldn't want to read about myself in a magazine. Somebody says, you know, something that I disagree with, and then you feel, you know, a little bit disheartened. So I don't know. There's been a lot of, you know, controversy, you know, that I've heard of. But ultimately anymore these days, we really kind of like find that stuff funny.
Controversy. Well, I'm sorry. I missed the controversy. What's the controversy?
I don't know. It's just, there's always, you know, I mean,
oh, there's always some kind of shit going on.
Yeah.
Always, this is a Led Zeppelin cover band and they don't have any fucking talent to play this shit, you know?
Yeah. Or
like, well, okay. So let's talk about that. Like, obviously you get tagged with that as a reference. Like, how do you guys deal with that? Do you find that affects your songwriting? You're like, fuck, I can't write a riff like that. Like they're going to just say it's fucking Jimmy Page again.
I would say that there are some songs that we reworked or didn't even get to recording because it was in the same realm as Led Zeppelin.
I think that was kind of more early on though.
Yes, yeah, so it was very early.
As far as the Battle of Garden's Gate, the newest album is concerned, that was absolutely not the case. But it was sort of, yeah, when people started throwing that comparison at you, like it was, you know, it was so common all the time. But it was sort of like an honor that somebody would compare you to that sort of thing that you all have sort of an appreciation for or you dig.
Because we're at the point in our careers now with the Battle at Garden's Gate where we are very confident in who we are as a band and our sound and what we are and why are we in this time?
Yeah.
Well, also, like, how do you guys deal with expectations from fans and people interested in your band? Because it seems like you also got tagged with the, you know, the saving rock and roll thing. You know, they're going to say this is the new saving rock and roll band. Like, how do you deal with those kind of ridiculous expectations?
I think we're more scared about not meeting our own expectations.
Yeah, that's generally where most of the pressure is, the pressure that we put on ourselves. But it's, I think, really creating the music that we want to create and putting that in front of people, being able to kind of provide something new, something that we, you know, we're curious about this or that and exploring concepts and making music that we're not hearing somewhere else necessarily. And sort of, I guess, that is why we have the inclination to create. So therefore that kind of removes fear a little bit as an obstacle or some, you know, because it kind of hinders the process if you're driven by fear. So it's easier said than done, but that's kind of what we generally aim to do.
Well, the record industry also, like, you know, if there's sort of the fan expectations, but then there's the business side of it and those expectations. And in the record industry, like any industry, if you sell, you know, 100,000 records, they expect you to sell 300,000 records next time. And it's this thing of like constant growth. So how do you guys deal with that side of it from the business side of it? You know, because bands, you know, naturally sort of do this oftentimes, you know?
Yeah. I don't know. I feel like we don't generally really give a shit. I think it's kind of, as long as we're making the music we want to make and the people who are interested in listening to it are listening to it, that's really what matters. I mean, we can be fat and irrelevant tomorrow, but as long as we're, you know, I don't know, as long as we're creating the art that we feel necessary to sort of share, then I think that we're satisfied.
And that should be the function of the record label, is to take the art that an signed artist or whatever supplies and take that and promote it. And they don't know what's best. They do not know what's best for humanity. They don't know what's best for this consumer.
I don't know what you're talking about, man. that's perfect. You're not supposed to say that out loud, dude. You're gonna get your fucking band dropped. Yeah, man.
I don't give a fuck anymore. We've had it. We've over this shit.
Is it true? You know, I've of course had to scour the internet, you know, to get some do a little research for this interview. Is it true that Elton John advised you guys to take on a more flamboyant image, which, you know, in your new video, I gotta say, it was popping.
Yeah, I believe what he said was flaunt what you've got. And yes. I mean, he'd come to a show. I mean, we'd been lucky enough to play with him, and we were doing some touring in the UK, and he came to one of the shows. And I think it was a club at that point, probably 2,500 people or something. And he sat in the balcony, you know, and watched kind of over. And that was kind of,
and we kept seeing people in the crowd be like,
yeah, they were tapping each other on the shoulders, right. Pointing, going, is that Elton John up there?
That looks just like Elton John.
So after the show, right. We came back and we just got chatting, you know, we talked about all kinds of stuff. But yeah, he's kind of like, don't be afraid to flaunt what you've got. He says, you're young guys, you're good looking, you're great musicians, great songwriters. Don't never be shy. Flaunt what you've got. And so that's what we fucking did.
It's full permission.
I love it, man. Like, you know, for a guy my age, I mean, I grew up in, you know, it was sort of like, you know, becoming really aware of rock and the image of it all in the 70s and through the 80s and stuff. So it's like, when I see your video, I'm like, fuck yeah. That's what a fucking rock band's supposed to look like. God damn it. Enough of these fucking shoegazers and fucking false humility. I want to see that.
Far out, brother. Thanks.
Well, fuck, man. Seriously, it's great to hear a band with like long stretched out guitar solos and doing the music that you guys make. And I just think it's great, man. I wish you the best. And thanks for sitting down and doing this with me, man. It's fun.
Yeah, thank you. We appreciate what you're doing.
Fuck yes. Yeah.
Well, I hope we get to, you know, hang out at a festival somewhere in the relatively near future, which I suspect will happen.
Yeah, I think so.
I think you're right.
Okay, yeah, that was Josh and Sam from Greta Van Fleet. Make sure you go check out their latest record, The Battle at Garden's Gate. It's really good rock and roll. I will be back next week with Imelda May. So you all just be safe until then. Take care. And make sure you go check out the Vans website and see if they've got any of those t-shirts left. Vans, Foot the Bill, Jensen Music, Foo Fighters, collaboration, baby. Get it while they're there. All right, adios, amigos.